You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, the on-hiatus stand-up comedian who has been discussing difficult viewing decisions of our collective past using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection each and every week for the last 8 years since 2014, and this week is no exception. Still haven't missed a week. I know I say that every week, but I'm proud of myself for so few things that it's nice to be proud of something. This week, my guest is someone I've wanted to have on the show literally since COVID started. She was one of the other guests on Alison Rosen's show with me on the last in-person Alison Rosen is Your New Best Friend episode Alison did before COVID hit. So we were like the last in-person group for over a year. And it's Jackie Johnson. And she is the host, creator, brilliant mind behind the Natch Beaut podcast. You can probably hear my cat. You often hear the dogs, but that's Bink. She likes to look out the window and yell at things. Now, someone who doesn't like to look out the window and yell at things, although frankly, I don't know if she does or not. Jackie is very funny, super smart. Her show is far, far, far more successful than mine, but I understand. This is a niche. So if you're a fan of hers and you're checking out this show because of that, welcome. I think you'll enjoy the show. Go back, listen to some old episodes, just see if there's anyone's name you recognize. Allison's done the show. Tony Thaxton's done the show, speaking of Allison's show. But this was fun. We talked about 2004, which is such a blank spot for me, which I mentioned in the show here of why that is. So that's always interesting, and I actually did learn quite a bit from Jackie. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Jackie Johnson.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Jackie Michelle Johnson, how are you?
I am so good, Ken. I am so excited to be here. So thank you for having me as I sit in my closet.
It's a good closet, though.
No, it's big. Not to brag. I just threw my arms up. I can completely flail my arms and not hit anything.
I heard no hitting. I didn't even hear a rustling of clothing.
This is the biggest closet I've ever had in my whole life.
This sounds like a cliche joke, but that is literally bigger than some bedrooms from people I've seen who had New York apartments.
No, this is bigger than most of the bedrooms I've had in LA. It's not that big, though. I don't want people thinking I'm like Joan Rivers.
It's fine. It's like 20 by 20. Yeah, it's not that big.
Yeah, it's fine. We like it.
Yeah. Now, is this, you and your husband have your own closets, or is this both, is this a joint closet?
We were going to share this closet. This is the closet attached to the primary bedroom.
Okay.
But he said he did not want to share a space with me, and so he got the hallway closet, and I respect his honesty. I'm a little messy, Ken. I don't know if you can see behind, there's a lot of clothes. I'm a little messier, and he's a neat freak. I'm going to say it.
Okay.
He's a neat freak. We don't agree in that aspect of our lives, so he put some boundaries up and let me have the whole closet, which I'm using to record because that audio, honey.
Perfect.
There's no echo in here. There's no echo in here.
Then you can write off your clothes as sound insulation.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm way ahead of you, hon.
Hold on. He has his like closet with his clothes and stuff is in the hallway?
Yeah. Yeah. Huh. He would rather inconvenience himself that much to avoid having to share with me.
This may be too personal, and feel free to not answer it, although it is about your husband and not you.
Yeah.
And has nothing to do with TV Guide. Now, when he, like, say, takes a shower, right?
Yeah.
Tell me in slow detail. No, so does he get his clothes and, like, bring in the clothes he's going to wear with him into the bathroom? Or is he, like, a kind of person who, like, has a staging area?
So here's what I imagine. So also, I've taken the whole primary bathroom as well.
Oh, okay.
So because we realize, and this might be similar for you, Ken, like we don't have children. We have two bathrooms in the house. Why share one when there's one sitting in the hallway?
That's true.
We came to this realization thinking, why are we both shoving our elbows into each other at night when we could just both have our own bathroom?
Yeah.
Like adults. So yeah. I don't know what the hell he's up to in that bathroom down the hall, and I don't care. That's his business. I think if I had to be honest, he would just be nude. He would walk nude
okay.
to get clothes or, you know, I don't think he would bring them with him.
See, there's a weird thing about, like, even though you're in your own house and it's just you two and no one else is going to see, there's no, like, windows in the way. It seems weird to do that to me. Like,
I
for
wouldn't
me.
Do it personally. No, I wouldn't do it personally, but you know what? Everybody's their own person.
That's true. That's
Everybody's
true.
Got their own thing going
Everyone's
on.
Everyone's got their thing.
Yes.
So speaking of nudity, the issue that we picked here is from January 3rd to the 9th, 2004. And I apologize. This was like the sixth issue you picked. And
yeah,
you kept telling me no. I couldn't find, like, and there were ones I knew I had. And I'm like, God, where, but I had this one.
Yep.
And you at first wanted to pick one that had the OC on it because
yep.
you love the OC. And we'll
yep.
talk about it here.
Yep.
But this one has Sex and the City on the cover, and it's the finale.
Yes.
I've
How exciting.
Never seen an episode of Sex
no!
and the City.
No! Oh my gosh. Ken, that upsets me.
I know my dad would try to get me to watch it, and he would be like, I mean, there's boobs in it.
There's definitely sex. It's in the title.
Yeah, it just
it's
seemed
in the title.
Not interesting
yeah.
to me.
Well, I'll say this. I converted to Judaism last year. And I had several people tell me I need to rewatch Sex and the City because, spoiler alert, Charlotte converts to Judaism at one
right.
point.
Okay.
So I went to just that storyline and watched four or five episodes. And my husband, at the time, fiance, was in the room kind of coming in and out. And he kept stopping and watching and enjoying and laughing. And he was like, I like this show. Put the pilot on. And we watched the entire series.
Wow.
Together. And both really enjoyed it. And I think he learned a lot about women. And he said, I wish I'd watched this in my 20s. So I think men need to go back and rewatch it. It holds up. In my opinion, Ken, this might be controversial. Top five favorite series of all time.
Really?
Easily.
Really?
Easily.
And consistently. Because it's like
yes.
10 seasons, right?
It's a... Oh gosh, I should know this. Six? It's six.
Okay.
It's six seasons. Five is split... into two, or season six is split into two, because 9/11 kind of fucked production up.
Freaking
it's a lot. It, it is yeah. a tall order, but they're 30-minute episodes, so it's not like a Lost or a
right.
Sopranos. You know, it's a little
right.
quicker, but well worth it, in my opinion. Some of it is a little cringy. Some things haven't held up, which is true for all kind of late 90s, mid-2000s shows. But it's really worth a watch,
so,
I think.
It always struck me as being about, like, rich ladies in Manhattan who, like, Seinfeld if it was all ladies in Manhattan. Is that inaccurate?
I see similarities there. They're
okay.
not all, I wouldn't say they're all rich, but they're privileged. Sure,
yeah.
they're privileged. They're educated. They have good jobs. It's a show about dudes, like, fucking and going out and talking really candidly about the women they fuck, except it's flipped and it's women.
Okay.
So that's why it's fun.
Okay. All
it's
right.
It's really
I see.
Fun. And especially as a woman now in her 30s watching it, I was like sobbing along with them. Like, I was like, oh my God, so and so is having a hard time getting pregnant. And oh my God, she, you know, her marriage fell apart. Like, I got divorced. So I was like, oh wait, there's a divorce spoiler alert. I'm like, oh, I've been through that, honey. Like, I really find it great television. It's really funny, great writing, wonderful acting.
Yeah, I mean, I like the cast, especially yeah. like the, I was going to say like the B characters, like
yes.
the supporting
no.
characters.
Fantastic guest actors every episode. So many celebrities pop up in little like under five, you know, wacky
yeah.
characters. I think you should watch it, Ken. I would watch the pilot.
I'll give it a try. Yeah. I the closest I've gotten as Amy Sedaris invited me to the premiere party for At Home with Amy Sedaris show
mm-hmm.
in New York
mm-hmm.
a couple of years ago, at which I had no business being at. It was like all famous people in this fancy hotel and then me. But like Sarah Jessica Parker was there and
yeah.
they're like best buds because I think
the
Amy's
toast
in a
of
few
New
episodes.
York.
Yeah.
Yeah, she is. She plays her publicist or
yeah.
her what's the woman who the runs I, you ever just can't think of the word the publisher her publisher
okay
that's it not publicist
yes.
her publisher
I mean very close words different
very
functions,
close words
very close words
yes
yeah.
yes
and now did you go full on like you watched the prequel Carrie Diary show and
I did
the
not
movies? Okay.
I did not I did go
okay.
to the movies I dressed up and went in theaters
oh
and
right.
the second movie is total garbage
okay.
Will I be watching the reboot? Of course I will.
Even
of course
though,
I will.
what's her name isn't in it?
Yes.
The mannequin lady.
Kim Cattrall. Well, it might be a nightmare, but I feel I owe it to the characters who have given me so much joy to at least check in with them and see where they're at.
Are you the kind of person that, like, once you start a show, you feel like a weird sense of loyalty and you have to stick with it for the whole time, even if it's terrible?
Yes, but I have bailed on a good amount. Just due to I don't have any damn time. I stopped watching Handmaid's Tale. I just... How many seasons have gone? Yeah. I just don't have the time. So I've fallen off on True Blood. I bailed on True Blood.
Yeah. Yeah. It got a little silly. I did that to Supernatural and I felt bad. But I was in for like 12 years.
Yeah, that show went forever.
Yeah. I was like, it's been a decade. I can bail now. Right. It's fine. 2004 is a weird year for me. So I just moved back from the UK and I'd been on and off living there for like a couple years in and out of the country, sort of. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of totally oblivious to most of the television going on.
Yeah.
And when I first opened this, I was really shocked, and I shouldn't be, but I was really shocked at how this is like 90% reality TV.
Right. The reality boom has definitely hit at this point. It is thriving.
It crested. I think it went down a little bit after this. Maybe. But maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. It's been a big thing for a long time.
Because this is like the blizzard of 2004. Reality shows storm your TV sets this winter. So we have American Idol 3, The Bachelorette, Celebrity Mole Yucatan, The Surreal Life, Survivor All-Stars, Average Joe Hawaii, I never even heard of, America's Next Top Model, not The Bachelorette, but some other thing with this woman. Average Joe's New Babe. I don't know what the premise of that show was.
I'll tell you what it is. It's literally dating in LA. It's hot women and a sort of average white guy that gets all these hot women, and we don't know why. It's literally like being a white guy in America.
Hey, it's like, you know, it hasn't been my experience, but that's fine.
Move to LA.
I wish I did. Did you grow up in Texas?
Yes. Okay. I grew up in Dallas, went to college in Austin, and then moved to LA, and I've been here for 15 years. So essentially my entire adult life has been in LA.
But you, like, Dallas and Austin are like the extremes.
Very different,
right?
Yeah.
I've been to Dallas Airport, but not Dallas itself. But
yeah.
Dallas Airport was one of the few places where I could 100% tell where I was just being in the airport.
Well, Texas loves to brand itself. It loves to make itself. We are Texas. We are big. We love leather. We love boots. We love the Texas flag. They really make it known wherever you go. And the branding in the airport is strong.
Literal branding. I think there was a guy with a branding iron.
Yes.
I didn't see a single woman who didn't have like full hair and makeup.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, that's a lot for
just
travel.
It really is. My sister, who is a feminist and, you know, she wears curlers and full makeup every day, even just to not even leave her house.
It must be a Texas thing.
A Texas thing. That's how we raise the ladies. I don't do that, but God bless them.
Did you watch Dallas growing up?
My parents did. I was a little young, so I remember seeing it and being in the room, but I didn't really cognitively remember any of it.
Yeah, which is kind of there.
Yes.
So you wouldn't be able to accurately judge if it was an accurate depiction of Dallas, Texas?
No, I believe it was. That certain niche of the wealthy and right. But I do know who shot JR.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do know that.
You want to spoil it for everybody? Spoil it. Do it.
Okay. It was a dream, right?
No, yes, but that was a different plot line.
Nobody shot JR and it was a dream and really happened.
So it did get reversed later, but his son, played by Patrick Duffy of Step by Step fame.
Yep.
At one point, he was supposed to have been killed, but then like it was a dream from his wife. Okay. She wakes up and he's in the shower.
Yes, that's what
thing.
I was referencing. Yeah. That's what I've seen that clip. I've seen on recaps and also Who Shot Mr. Burns. I am familiar with that. A lot of pop culture moments I lived first through The Simpsons.
Oh, you're not alone there.
And then later when I would see like a Twilight Zone episode in film school or something, I'd be like, oh, I remember The Simpsons did that.
So. Yeah, The Simpsons spoiled this
for
me.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. There's some interesting stuff in here too. There's Scrubs was big, which I actually enjoyed.
I did too.
But if you rewatched it, it's the most dated show.
No. Scrubs had its own thing going on. It had fanatic watch, like, people, Scrub fans are really into Scrubs, and then there's the middle ground where I'm like, I watched it if it was on, it was cute, and then there's people who, like, have never watched an episode.
Yeah, it's weird. Like, I think it started the same season or a season after Grey's Anatomy. Like, they kind of started at the same time.
The yin and yang, for sure.
I think Grey's Anatomy's still on, isn't it?
It's still on. How and they've killed off everyone. They've killed off everyone. Meredith Grey, and there's one other person I won't spoil just in case. They're the only two characters left because everybody's like, I want to move on with my career. And they've done helicopter crashes, Ebola outbreaks. I mean, everything you can think of to kill off everybody so that they can leave and go do a movie or something.
Which they did with ER, but it seems sillier for some reason in Grey's Anatomy, but maybe that's just me.
No, it's silly because there's been like multiple helicopter crashes. And after a while, you're like, did somebody put a curse on this hospital? Like,
yeah,
why like
you'd think
so
you'd be able to sort that out. Yeah.
Yeah, like maybe take the bus. I don't know.
Scrubs had a thing where they rebooted with like a whole new cast for the last season as well.
Oh,
and like
interesting.
People weren't having it. It was like, all the new interns. But there's a little article in here, and I totally forgot about this, but Brendan Fraser and Tara Reid play Dr. Cox's son and his wife on the show.
I didn't know that.
And this was the this was like that 10-year period where Brendan Fraser had disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was like a big deal that he was in this thing.
Yeah, he's back all of a sudden.
And I always liked him. He's always fun in things.
Yeah, he's nice. And he's tall, which I appreciate a tall man.
Same height as me and roughly the same build when I was in better shape.
There you go. You could be a stand-in.
Well, they filmed that movie Furry Vengeance here with him in it.
Oh, fun.
And a Boston casting was like emailing me incessantly to be a lighting double. And I was like, I'm not doing that. And they're like, but it's $50 for an all night shoot.
Oh, no. you deserve way more than that.
Yeah, at least 100.
Yeah, come
on. There's also a Charlie's Angels made for TV movie in here, which I didn't even know existed.
No, I don't think it hit any big marks.
And it looks like, does it say who's playing Farrah Fawcett? It looks like Trisha Hefner, or whatever her name is, from Battlestar. Yeah, Trisha Hefner from Battlestar Galactica is playing Farrah Fawcett.
Good for her. I never watched Battlestar Galactica. I'm sure I would like it, though.
It's kind of a bum out. It's pretty depressing. Yeah, it's like mostly about like Islamic jihad and like torture.
Oh, wow. That's not what I thought. Because I like Next Generation. I thought it was something sort of like that.
Oh, no. See, Next Generation is sort of unique in the sci-fi world in that it's very utopian, despite the Borg.
Okay.
It's very utopian and kind of like hopeful.
Okay.
And Battlestar Galactica is just brutal.
Okay,
it's like,
well,
it's,
I don't need that. Nobody does right now.
You definitely don't. We also get John Cryer in here. There's a bunch of people who are sort of making a comeback before, like now who are staples on television. So it's this weird transitional year. And an ad that made me really sad. You probably know what it is.
The Nicoderm ad?
No.
Oh, the Trim Spa ad.
Yes.
Yeah. I saw this too. It made me sad, too.
Anna Nicole Smith in Trim Spa, and A, it's sad anyway, because it's like a Trim Spa ad, but she 100% was the first person literally killed by reality television.
It's a really sad story, and I did watch her reality show, and I did find her to be a fascinating person, and her Trim Spa ads are iconic. And I know that word gets thrown around by millennials, but it truly, they really were iconic Trim Spa baby. It is a catchphrase that has stuck with me. And she's a great beauty and a great pop culture icon of my generation. And
yeah.
we respect and we'll miss you, Anna Nicole. And this ad did kind of,
And
we have a $5 coupon, Ken, so we could
still works.
Go get some.
Didn't they take that off the market? Wasn't it like super unhealthy?
Yeah. All of them are not great.
No.
All of them are not great.
But she kind of gets forgotten now. And that show was like, everyone laugh at her. She's stupid and drugged up. And then she died and everyone was like, forget we were laughing at that. Let's just move
on. Truly, this was true for so many characters on television, characters meaning humans that were exploited on reality television, specifically women. And now we're all going back and analyzing how we treated women. Look at Paris Hilton, Britney Spears, all these figures of this era where they were just mercilessly wrecked in the media. And Anna Nicole was one of those victims. And it's sad that she's not here. She was.
I don't know if we've really faced the reckoning we deserve for all that stuff yet.
Truly.
It was almost 20 years ago, some of this stuff. Then there's a whole thing about it's called Dressed for Sex, which is not an accurate title.
No, that's just to get people to look and read. Yeah.
Which is weird because it's in the middle of the magazine. Like, you already bought it. Do we need to fool you?
Yeah, like, people love a silly headline, you know.
So this is all just Sarah Jessica Parker in various, mostly terrible outfits.
Yeah, it can, because you haven't watched Sex City, you don't know, but the outfits are wacky. Particularly the ones SJP wears, as you can see from this display here, they are wacky. And the one thing that is inaccurate about this show is that every day she's in a new designer outfit. Because, of course, nobody wants to see Carrie in the same thing. We watched the show to see her crazy outfits. But these are particularly some of the silliest ones. And I truly enjoyed this. I read every word in this and looked over everything. I also was going to ask, Ken, your opinion. If you were a huge fan of a show and you get an article and it says spoilers for the finale, are you going to read it? Because I'm like, why would I want to read that? I've watched this show for 6 years and I want to read the ending before it even comes out?
It depends on the show. So there are some shows where, like, the plot doesn't interest me as much as just, like, the how it's done, like the characters and the sort of way it unfolds. Yeah. The other thing is, there are some shows, Sex and the City, I assume not being one of them, that sort of 21st century, they're just the worst possible thing happens to everybody, and it's just the most bum out, awful. Everybody is just destroyed. So those I will read the spoiler, because then I'm like, do I really want to watch this?
Yeah.
Like, I was on a plane beforeantine. This was ages ago, almost two years ago.
Oh, beforeantine. Beforeantine. I like that.
And whatever that movie was, where I don't even remember the actor. Someone's like a plane crash, and they're like lost in the Arctic or something. It came out in the last couple of years.
I'm remembering it was two big actors, right?
Yeah, I think it was like Reese Witherspoon or something.
Oh no, it was Idris Elba.
Yes.
Yes, and somebody.
Yes. So this woman.
So bad for whoever it is.
I know.
Well, I haven't seen it, to be fair.
If you're in a movie with Idris Elba, that's the one.
Yeah, there you go. You got a payday.
Yeah, exactly. So the woman who was like sort of kitty-cornered across the aisle from me turns to the person next to her and she goes, "Excuse me, can I ask you a weird question?" And he's like, "Yeah, I guess." She's like, "I want to watch this movie, but I don't want to watch it if the dog dies. Can you, like, Google it for me and tell me if the dog dies?" So the guy's like, "Oh, yeah, sure." And then he's like, "Oh, dog's okay." And she's like, "Oh, okay, thanks."
Wow. So it didn't get that dark, because you know they would just barbecue that dog up after a few days if they were dying.
Yeah. I feel like they should give you dog warning deaths for every movie. Like, every Wes Anderson movie, a dog gets killed.
Yeah, it's horrible. Ken, would you eat one of your dogs? I would not. If I was starving, I would rather be dead.
No, same. Absolutely wouldn't. Yeah, I'd chew my wrists open. Same. I'd let them eat me.
Same. I would do the same. I would do the same. Absolutely not. I would never eat my dog. Yeah.
I think I'd eat a person first.
Yeah. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo of like the 10 people that survived. You're like, sorry, sorry, Gus. No, nope. Your time has come.
Got three dogs to feed here. So in this show, though, was it like commented that our outfits look ridiculous, or were they like supposed to be like, she looks cool?
Yeah. She's a fashionista. And all fashionistas take risks, and I will not ever claim to be somebody who knows anything about fashion, and apparently every single outfit that you're looking at is a fashionable choice.
I mean, there's one here that is the weirdest use of a belt I've seen since Cherry Johnson.
Yeah.
And it's sort of, it's above her belly button, but below.
Well, there's no clothing underneath it. That should be stated. It would be like wearing a tie with no shirt.
Which the Chippendales do very well.
I was about to say, that is a thing. I'm trying to think of another analogy. It's very silly.
It is a little silly, yeah. It's the equivalent of shirtless sleeves.
Yes, exactly. It would be like wearing sleeves.
Yes. And then there's one where she's dressed like, sort of like a newsie.
Mm-hmm.
Who is also like an undercover, like sailor?
Uh huh. I was gonna say an undercover woman of the night.
Yeah, there's sort of like a weird, like nautical vibe though too.
Yes.
Like, is that Carrie newsboy did a prostitute?
Exactly. Carrie did a lot of nautical looks. I want to say
the flat cap really, and then the St. Pauli girl look is like, that's too much.
Yeah.
It's just a costume.
Yeah. Listen, Ken, you got to watch. That's all I got to say. The outfits really fit in when you get the vibe of the show.
All right. All right.
I just wonder, I've never lived in New York. I remember watching this with my cousin who lived in New York at the time, being like, no women dress like that. They're all wearing sneakers because they have to schlep through the city all the time. And I'm like, yeah. Is that true? Do people in New York dress cooler than everyone else? I feel like that must be true.
I don't know. So I used to go down there a lot to do stand-up, and I'm not a big fan of New York. I always say it's like Boston. Everything bad about Boston with additional bad things.
Mm-hmm.
And there's like no escape. It's just like right on. It smells, and everyone's kind of mad, and they're mad that they're there, and they're mad that you're there, and you didn't. Yep. But like if you go to like sort of the fashion district, people dress kind of like, you can tell they go to like fashion design school. Right. But for the most part, everybody's just dressed like everybody else. It's not.
Yeah. I don't want to piss off New Yorkers, but I agree with you. It's not for me.
No.
It's I've moved to LA. I said, where would I like to live? I have to live somewhere on the coast where things are happening. New York. Nope. I had to come here just because New York was not for me.
No, it's the people who buy into it, who love it, like love it for all the reasons I don't.
I think if you have money and you're young, it's perfect because you don't know any better. You don't need personal space. You don't need a lot of money. You don't need. I'm tired. I need a nice, quiet room to sleep.
Oh, yeah.
Space.
Yeah, that's anywhere. Like if you're rich, of course, it's great to live there. But like New York, I'm like, when I would do shows in New York, I'm like, everyone's at this show because they hate their roommate and they're 40 years old and they live in a shitty apartment.
Yes.
Whereas when I'm in LA, I'm like, everyone's at this show because they just want to go out and have a good time.
Yep.
They could have stayed at home. Would have been nice.
Yep. Yep.
So it's nice.
Yep.
The next article here I will mention, it's he who cannot be named, who I've taken to referring to as the Grimace on the show.
Mm-hmm.
And this is about his reality show and an article about how to impress him.
This doesn't hold up.
No. Well, it says blonde hair in a miniskirt won't hurt.
Oh, God. It's so nasty.
I'm just like, that's revolting.
It really is.
Ugh. Ugh.
Yeah. We can talk about this show more when we get to the schedule.
We'll get to when it's on.
Because I have notes.
Oof. And then this thing I totally forgot about, and this looks like a joke. The Scott Peterson trial.
Yes.
And Dean Cain, speaking of the Grimace, noted Grimace supporter Dean Cain, is playing Scott Peterson. Dean Cain, who told me personally that he doesn't believe CTE is a thing because he played football in college.
Oh. A lot to unpack there.
I don't remember exactly this guy. Like, he got accused of killing his wife, or he killed his wife, or something like that. But Dean Cain's wearing the least convincing wig and goatee I've seen.
Yeah, that looks straight from the Party City, you know.
Yes.
Bargain bin section. It's not good.
It looks, you know what it looks like?
Did he have not grown out facial hair for this?
It looks like a really bad Louis C.K. impression.
Yes. Yep.
Like someone was trying to do an edgy web video 3 years ago. That's what this looks
like. A
low
budget Funny or Die sketch.
Oh, because he's got like red hair. And yeah, I totally forgot about this thing. I didn't know that Dean Cain was in it. I'm a little cringe interested to see how terrible it is.
Oh God, I bet it's. Do you listen to Howard Stern?
Not of recent note, but I used to on and off.
Dean Cain has a whole storyline in the lore of Howard because his Ronnie the limo driver used his body for his body in a promo shot, and so he comes up all the time. That's honestly my only frame of reference for Dean Cain. I'm going to be honest. I'm not familiar even with his work.
So he was Superman in the Lois and Clark show in the 90s.
Okay.
He basically is
an I know. Okay, yeah. I see it now. I guess his bad wig and bad goatee are throwing me off.
His disguise worked. One of my favorite Dean Cain star, and I've told this on the show before, but it's been far too long. I used to do a lot of conventions, and they would have me run like Q&As and that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I did one locally, and Dean Cain was there.
Oh.
And my friend, a couple of guys that have been on the show, Nick Chambers, who's like a musical genius, they did a fake podcast recording at the convention of a fake podcast called The Caniacs.
Oh,
that's
man.
All about Dean Cain, and they just love Lois and Clark season 2. So they literally set up, they didn't even record it. They set up like a table, like they're doing a live podcast. And then for an hour, they talked about Dean Cain and he's in the room looking so uncomfortable. And then at at the end, someone's like, well, we gotta sing the closing song, which there isn't one. And Nick gets up and he starts singing, I Get By With A Little Help From My Friends, but he changed the words to like Dean A Little Cain With My Friends. And everyone's singing and Dean Cain was horrified, a little bit flattered, and just had no idea what to do with it. And it was one of my favorite moments in my whole life.
I'm really glad that they didn't go with Get By With A Little Help From Dean Cain, because that's where my brain would go. And I really appreciate that they added that extra level of wacky to it.
Yes. Yeah.
That extra level
of surreal activity. Yes. You got a Dean looking. And then there's another, and I normally don't talk about the articles this much, but this one is just packed full. There's a thing that's playing on an old cigarette ad, which surprises me. So this is about flat screen TVs. Mm-hmm. And it says thin and rich. And the reason it says that is because there literally used to be in the 60s and 70s, there was a cigarette ad that said, I like my cigarettes like I like my women, thin and rich. So it's a weird thing for them to reference.
Right. I didn't know that. I just thought they were trying to once again be like edgy.
Yeah. Like sad edgy, like old man.
Right.
It's not good. And then the worst of 2003, I don't know what this show is that they're talking about here, but I think it's a woman dressed as a man, but on page 51, mm-hmm. but it just looks like that Dean Cain outfit.
Yeah, that's the same goatee. They just used it. They probably hired the same makeup artist.
Guys got any goatees hanging around?
Yeah. Oh, we do. We have this Dean Cain one. Let me dust it off.
Yeah. No, it looks like felt, but it's not. So let's dive in here. On Saturday night, no, in Texas, were you in Central Time?
Yes.
Okay. So this will be a little bit of a compromise for you.
Yes.
Because you Central Time kids got an extra hour.
Yes. I had to translate things for the Central Time zone. So in this time period, this was early 2004, I was in college and I was in my dorm room. So I had a TV that was on all the time, but it was a very tiny little TV. It was not thin and rich, you could say. It was a very tiny little TV, but I'd go over to friends' houses and stuff with nicer TVs. But
did you get cable in the dorm room?
Oh, yeah, of course. Oh, okay. This was before nobody had cable anymore. Cable was a necessity. And I think... Right. We had whatever the dorm cable was. You couldn't buy your own packages and get we all had a set amount of channels and that's what they were. But there were some included.
And so were you like, Saturday night, I got to watch in my dorm room.
So Saturday night, I chose to watch The Ring on HBO.
Okay.
The reason I've chosen that is because I've honestly only seen it once. And I thought, this would be a fun time to watch this. Why not? Saturday night horror movie? I've only seen it once. And I actually never saw it until semi-recently. I only saw it a couple years ago. I did. But this movie had a lot of hype around it. When it came out, everybody said how scary it was. Everybody was going to see it. So it was one of those things where I rejected it because the hype was so much that I said, I'm just going to see how long I can now go without seeing it. And I went a very long time. But I saw it on here and I said, it's Saturday night. It's movie night. Let's watch a movie. Let's get spooky. The Ring on HBO.
Woman after my own heart. I am also contrarian when it comes to films.
Yep.
I saw it once. I saw it in the theater when it came out. Never saw it again. I remember thinking it was okay. I'm the kind of jerk that saw the original Japanese one prior to that and was like... but
I bet that's way scarier, right?
It is, but part of that is because I think... when something's in a foreign language and the sort of cultural norms are a little bit weird, you're already kind of uncomfortable.
Yep.
So it's already like, I am inherently scared in countries where they don't speak English. Cause I feel like I couldn't ask for help.
Mm-hmm.
So like not unconsciously, that's always kind of there. So it's scarier, but
have you been to Japan?
No, I've always kind of wanted to go.
You would love it.
You've been?
I've been. And I mainly was in Tokyo, so a lot of people speak English. A lot of the signs are in English. You know, we are very privileged. I went off the grid a little bit, and there was only one guy that worked at the hotel that spoke English, and every time we needed something, they would, like, call him, and he'd bike over from his, you know, home right, and, like, talk to us. But, no, they're very accommodating there. We're lucky. We, again, are privileged and lucky. Most countries do accommodate us in some way.
I am really not well traveled. The only country I've been to aside from the US is England.
Yeah. And they speak English there.
Haven't been to Canada. Yeah. Haven't been to Mexico. Haven't even been, I haven't even been to the other countries we can drive to.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, it's a long drive, though.
It's true. It's true. Yeah. But still technically possible. Yeah, The Ring's not a bad movie. I can't blame you there. Saturday night horror movies, get a pizza. Like, that's a good time.
Yeah.
You did pass up a horror movie of a different kind, though. Ernest Goes to School.
That's true. And you know what? I should watch that. I would like to get high, eat an edible, and watch that.
Have you seen any of the Ernest movies?
I have, but it's been so long. When I was little, I loved them. Like, Ernest Scared Stupid, I remember enjoying very much.
It's Ernest Scared Stupid's a good Halloween movie. I will say that. And Ernest Saves Christmas is a fantastic Christmas movie.
Okay, I'm going to...
It's genuinely good.
Is there any way I can change my answer? Because
I'll allow it.
Okay, because now I really want to watch the Ernest movie. Ernest Goes to School?
That one, not so good. So there's like three or four Ernest movies. I think there's seven Ernest movies.
Yeah, good for him.
Ernest Goes to Africa?
Oh.
Ernest Goes to School and Ernest Goes to Jail. Mm, yeah. But like Ernest Saves Camp, pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, Ernest Goes to Camp, pretty good. Ernest Saves Christmas, amazing. Ernest Scared Stupid, very good.
Great. Okay. Yeah. So you're saying I should stick with The Ring?
Stick with The Ring.
Okay, I'm going to stick with The Ring. You know what? As women, we always question our instincts. No. First choice, The Ring. I'm sticking with it. I'm sticking with it. Yes.
I thought you were going for a woman joke about rings.
Oh, no, honey. I've already had two of those. I'm good. I'm set.
Yep. I got enough. You know, I've noticed I watch Judge Judy all the time because I love her. She's been on for 25 years. Mm-hmm. And there used to be a lot more cases of people like not returning an engagement ring.
Mm-hmm.
Like at least twice a week there was that.
Wow.
I haven't seen one of those cases in at least a decade.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're just not booking those or it just isn't happening anymore.
How interesting. I kept mine just for reference. I kept mine. I kept my ring, but my ring wasn't worth very much.
Oh, so do you still have it?
I gave it to my niece.
Oh,
who's and you four? Guys,
you're getting married.
Yeah, I proposed to her. Yeah.
Oh, that's.
Uh-oh.
You gave it to a 4-year-old. That's so much. That's like the worst possible thing you could do
in the eyes
of the person who bought it.
Yeah, it's fine.
I love that. So that's what you're watching all night Sunday. Yep. What'd you do?
Okay, well, I do see that it is Super Bowl Sunday, which is exciting.
Which I didn't even know.
No, I didn't either. And it's Oklahoma. I'm from Texas. I'm not a big fan of Oklahoma. You know what? I'm not going to watch it.
Who is Oklahoma playing?
It says versus LSU.
Oh, that's not the Super Bowl.
Oh,
right?
No. Oh, it's the Sugar Bowl. I'm sorry.
Sugar Bowl.
I can't read. So, no, I don't care. That is not on my list. I'm not watching it.
Okay.
Sunday, I'm excited for this. So, first up, we're going to be watching MTV Cribs.
Okay.
Now, Ken, have you ever watched MTV Cribs?
I have watched MTV Cribs. In every cliche that people talk about MTV Cribs, it was in the two or three episodes I have seen.
Yeah, I used to love MTV Cribs. This era in particular, I believe Suchin Pak was the narrator, and I am now friends with Suchin Pak. I have manifested her into my life. She's been on my podcast, and so I'm obsessed with her, so I have to throw it back and watch Cribs, especially now that I am a homeowner. I'm always looking for new design tips. I would love to see...
From the early 2000s.
Yes, I would love to see the design.
You want a stripper pole and disco ball?
Exactly. And a Scarface DVD. Remember everybody would show. So I had to go back and watch Cribs for the first hour. But then at 9, honey, we're going to HBO and we're watching Sex and the City and Curb. Of course. Of course we're going to watch Sex and the City and Curb.
The perfect thing for the Lord's Day.
Exactly.
Sex and the City and Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Exactly. Well, I am Jewish now, so it's education for me.
Yeah. So I did watch Curb Your Enthusiasm. Sometimes I would have difficulty watching it because it's just so cringy.
Oh, like, yeah.
I just couldn't.
Yes.
But I would generally watch that. Sunday nights for me was like Antiques Roadshow all the time.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Loved it. I would watch Cribs occasionally because I'm super nosy about other people's houses.
Yes.
And again, before quarantine, like I will go to open houses.
Yeah.
I will go to estate sales.
Yeah.
Mostly because they're just like, oh, this stranger's house? Yeah, just walk around wherever you want.
Yep.
Go through their cabinets.
I love an estate sale. I've been going to them a lot.
I love
them. And, oh, man, there's so many. You would love the ones out here. I went to this one the other day. It had thick, thick shag carpet. Yellow. I've never seen carpet this thick. It was disgusting. But it was amazing. It was amazing. It was like a 70s house.
So we propose a movie, right? That's like Jurassic Park, except instead of the DNA being stuck in insects in
it's
amber,
in dirty
it's
shag
in that
carpet.
And then we can just reanimate 70s.
This family.
LA.
Yes.
Yeah. I like it.
Oh, I'm writing it.
Perfect. Yeah, I love those. Because then it's just crazy, too. They're like, go through the drawers. I don't know. You want anything? We'll sell it to you.
Oh, it's so weird. You're like literally digging through somebody's drawers.
Yeah.
They haven't done any kind of preemptive cleanup or anything. Literally, you could go through their garbage if you want.
Oh, yeah. And if you want to make an offer on anything.
Yes.
I'm always intrigued by it. There's always like a couple forbidden rooms.
Yes. There's like a weird piece of duct tape across it. It says, no, nothing for sale in here.
Not part of the sale. And I'm like, I really want to know what's in that room.
I do, too.
And I imagine it's just like a human-sized doll in a rocking chair.
Oh. But somebody would buy that.
Oh, of course.
So it's their loss.
Yes, it's true.
Yeah.
So Sex and City, this is the finale.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Were you watching this at the
Absolutely.
Time? Like, did you have a big party?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And the girls
I watched
over?
It. Everybody. We were all there. We were all sobbing, holding each other. Our periods all started simultaneously.
Started and ended.
Yes.
Yeah, it's funny. I can't think of many shows. And again, obviously, we're in a global pandemic, so this is not as relevant. But since past the year 2000, where people have had like an event, we got to watch the finale or like, let's all get together.
Yes.
I guess people do that with like The Bachelor.
Mm-hmm. But that feels more like just for a joke, kind of. Does anybody actually enjoy The Bachelor?
I can't
imagine. It's an ironic watch.
It has to be.
Yeah, I've never watched it.
It's weird where people do that for a scripted show. Like, that's always, I miss that. Like, we're going to get together and watch Twin Peaks, or like, we're watching the ER finale, or like, whatever it is.
Game of Thrones, I would say, is a big one.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I've also never seen that.
What?
I know.
Wow.
Yeah, my knowledge of TV, like, post-millennium is really weak.
I'm the opposite. I'm flipped. Oh, you got it.
Sopranos.
Oh,
never
my
seen,
God.
Never seen Breaking Bad.
What?
No, I watched the first season of Mad Men and then couldn't watch it anymore because I'm like, everyone's an asshole. This sucks.
Oh, it is. Yeah. It makes you, if you binge Mad Men, you start drinking and you start calling everyone around you horrible names and it gets deeply embedded into your psyche. I don't recommend binging that show.
Yeah. There is a show here that I totally forget about, but when I saw this, I was reminded that I actually remember enjoying it, and it was called American Dreams, and it was a scripted show, but it took place in like the '50s and sixties.
I never watched it, but I've heard it's great. I remember I have a few friends who were on it.
Oh, really?
Like small parts, you know.
But so you weren't friends with Brad Paisley, who plays Ricky Nelson, or Jennifer Love Hewett, who plays Nancy Sinatra in this episode.
I saw Jennifer Love Hewett at a Bed Bath & Beyond once.
Really? What'd she buy?
She was buying pillows with her boyfriend, Jaime Kennedy.
Oh, not Jaime Kennedy.
I know.
Yeah. See, so Jaime Kennedy, I don't know if you know him at all.
I've met him. If you live in LA long enough, you have a Jaime
Kennedy
story.
Yeah. He's not a good person, best I can recall.
Yeah.
And so he does a thing that Pauly Shore does as well. So that tells you right away what kind of people do this.
I have several Pauly Shore stories
as
well.
Oh, God. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I get some real good ones. So I'll have to share with you off mic. But they'll hire someone to open the show for them. And if it's like a Friday, Saturday, and they always fire them after the first night.
Why?
Because they just like doing it. Well, they just like doing that. Mm-hmm. So they'll just be like, yeah, just hire anyone the first. I don't care. And then they like get off on firing them and then having someone else do the second night. But Jaime Kennedy, he was doing shows in Connecticut, I think, and selling his merch, Jennifer Love Hewett.
Oh, wow.
I was like, she could do so much better than this.
Wow.
So much better.
Remember what I said about Average Joe Hawaii? Hello.
Yeah, I know.
I'm telling
Jesus
you,
Christ.
This is a man's world.
I picked the wrong place to live. But she, thinking about it, she's a good Nancy Sinatra without even having seen it.
She's a great actress.
Yeah, I need to look up the show again. And then, of course, inside the actor's studio, which was a whole phenomenon I forgot about.
Yes. Jeez, but I never watched it live. I would watch that every once in a while if I saw it on and there was nothing else going on. But it was always really interesting.
It was interesting at the time. When I've gone back and watched them, and we're so spoiled with like podcast interviews and stuff.
Yes.
It's the most pompous, boring, ridiculous thing. And it's just such self-parody. But it was cool at the time.
Yeah, your favorite curse word, right? That was like
yes.
Big
What's
thing.
Your favorite curse word?
Yeah, and then they'd bleep it, and we didn't even know what they said.
Yeah, and do you do this? I do this whenever if my TV fritzes out for a second or like whatever it is, I always insert a swear.
I'm going to start doing that now.
It's really fun.
Yeah,
it's really fun. So this isn't even the finale. I'm sorry. This is the beginning of the final eight episodes.
Oh. Might as well be the finale because I was that excited.
Which is weird because it's literally the cover story and it's not even the finale. They're like, hey, everyone, look, eight more episodes. Yeah.
But it was like one long one drawn out over 8 weeks.
Because this was like she was going to marry somebody. Like, was there an overarching plot?
Oh, yeah, Ken, there's a lot to unpack. She moves to Paris.
As we all do.
She leaves the city. The titular city. She leaves it. And we see what happens.
Is she going to come back?
You know what? You're going to have to watch.
Oh, man.
Why would I ruin that? Or read this damn article that literally spoils everything. I'm so annoyed.
I'll binge it. I can't sleep until I finish every episode.
Good luck.
All right. That's Sunday. So what'd you do Monday?
Okay, so Monday I had to do my good duties because I was in 2004 at this very moment attending University of Texas. I said, well, I need to watch University of Texas basketball on ESPN. And
At Providence.
And I actually am not a big sports watcher, but the one sport I can handle is basketball because it is fast-paced. There's always scoring involved. I actually can watch basketball and enjoy it. So I watched that game, right? And then, you know what? I had to check out Average Joe Hawaii. I had to see what was going on. I feel like I need to know what this show is about. I need this in my cultural handbook. So I said, okay, color me intrigued, NBC. I'm going to tune in. I'm going to see what happens on Average Joe Hawaii. So I had to see what was going on. Call me crazy. They got me with the promo at the beginning.
Yeah, I mean, it's on the front of the TV guide.
It's
so
on
they're
the
like
front.
Endorsing it. Quite a bit there.
Yeah.
And this is, it just seems to be The Bachelor, but with like a nerd.
I thought it was a bunch of hot women and an average looking dude, which again is just LA dating. So
but it's the opposite.
Wait, what do you mean?
So,
the women are all trying to pick the guy.
There's one woman who's really hot.
Oh.
And then all the dudes are just like schlubs.
Oh, so it, okay, okay. Yeah. I want to go on this. Okay.
Yeah, so if you go on page 147, it has a picture of the woman and then all the whole lineup.
Oh, man. Okay. I need to watch this.
So I don't mean this as an insult to people who work in IT, but this looks like just the IT department of any random company. That's exactly what these people look like.
Okay, well, I'm glad that I made this decision. I just need to see what this was about. Because this is Average Joe Hawaii, you know that there was at least one other iteration of this show.
Which I also don't remember. And you know who hosts this?
Who?
Kathy Griffin.
Hell yes! Okay, so this is good. This is a good show.
Yeah, so this is the second season sends another beauty queen to the islands to meet 18 Mr. Wrights who all look wrong for her.
Oh my god.
Before she sends four of them home, the fellows get a chance to win her over with their personalities.
Oh man. Maybe I shouldn't watch this because it's like my whole life playing out on television.
Right
about the IT yearbook photo. I'm looking
right
at it now. Yeah.
Right?
But I gotta see who she picks. I'm intrigued, Ken. I need to know.
Any one of those guys could help you with your IT problem.
Can you imagine her making out with some of those dudes? I gotta watch this. Yeah, I'm gonna find this show and watch it.
I'm sure it's on YouTube. Now I have to look it up as well.
Yeah, I gotta see what happens. What if they're married now with like five kids?
I would be shocked.
Yeah,
but
you never
maybe.
You never know.
And I'm curious how long that show went on. We know at least two seasons, but it's still not on. There's a channel that I loved and I forgot about called Trio. Mm-hmm. And Trio just disappeared. But Trio used to do this amazing thing called Brilliant But Canceled.
Uh-huh.
And so they would show shows that were like one season or half a season and have like wraparound segments where they'd interview people from the show, and like, which was really weird to do on television. Yeah. And there's an ad in here they're showing Now and Again, which was a show from 99.
I remember that show.
Which I don't remember, but I remember everybody saying it was good.
Yeah.
And the plot is crazy. It's five nights of the drama about a super being who's given a dead man's brain.
Wow.
I thought it was like a cop show.
I thought it was some kind of time travel thing.
It might be. There's a dead man's brain. And then I forgot how massive Fear Factor was.
Yes.
And tonight is just a ridiculous gimmick episode of Fear Factor. It's all twins.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And as I was scrolling, there's these two blonde twins that I literally thought was the band Nelson.
Uh-huh.
Until I scrolled a little further and saw they had massive fake boobs.
I feel like I've seen this episode of Fear Factor. I feel like it's ingrained in my brain. If only I could go back in time and have my dad audition. My dad is an identical twin. And,
okay.
He doesn't have amazing tits, and I think he would be okay still with me time. Saying that. That's true. But I, you know, it's never too late. Get on reality TV. Fear Factor was crazy and honestly traumatic.
Oh yeah. Well,
like, looking back mentally, that show does not hold up. It is not okay to torture people for TV.
No, and it gave us Joe Rogan.
Yep, news radio did,
but this really gave us the Joe Rogan that we all know today.
The Joe Rogan experience, you could say.
Yeah. Do your research. Something to think about. Yeah. But yeah, it was just people eating bugs. Like, all right.
But no, they would like drop people really fast. And like, it just was all kinds of weird, scary crap.
Yeah, I'm not into it.
Do you remember that show? I think it was on Sci-Fi Network, and I can't remember
Fear
the name
Factor?
Where they would scare people.
That show was created by a kid I went to high school with.
Wow, that show was fucked up.
Because the people legitimately thought they were going to die.
Yes, I'm telling you, it's dark. They had like zombies attack people's car and it's especially for a woman, like nobody, I tell my husband all the time, I'm like, never scare me. Never hide in the room and jump out at me because you think it's funny. Like, women live in fear of that all the time. I don't need in my house.
Yeah, it was not like Michael Carbonara, who's a magician, has a show called The Carbonara Effect. Like, they don't make people think they're going to die. Sometimes it goes a little bit too far into that. Yeah. Legitimately, there are people praying. They've clearly let go of what was in their bladders and bowels.
Oh yeah.
And they're like, that's it, I'm gonna die because there's a murderer. And they're like, oh, we got you.
I know. And then they laugh. I think some of them were like, are you kidding me? You just fucking gave me a heart attack. Like, I hope they sued because that was intense.
Yeah. I mean, it was because like punk, it was trying to be more extreme than punked, basically, which was huge.
Yes. Yes.
It was just, that was cringy. Yes. I can't believe that show was on as long as it was.
It was wild.
And it was hosted by Shannon Doherty.
Yes, which is so random.
And then she was
seems
replaced.
Like such a nice lady.
By Tracy Morgan.
Wow. Wow.
Just like on 90210 when he replaced her.
That was a wild move.
That was crazy, but it worked. It worked. It was really strange.
It did work.
There's also the new version of Las Vegas with James Caan. Like, there's all these shows I totally
forgot about. I used to do background
about
on that show.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Did you ever meet Jimmy Caan or anyone?
No, I what's his name? Fergie's husband, Josh Duhamel. I worked with him a good amount. He was really nice. Molly Sims. I worked with pretty much all of them except for James Caan.
Yeah, I imagine he's like, I'm not getting out of the trailer until you say action.
Exactly, and he's not going to look anybody in the eye.
No.
No, but it was a really fun show to work on, ice cold on the set, but I was sort of an established casino worker gal. I had this really like wacky pink corset, and I would carry drinks. It was fun.
Yeah. Is that the show you had the most screen time
on? I think
it
was. Yeah. Well, not screen time, just that I worked on it a lot.
Right.
Because once you've worked on a show a good amount of times, if you're an employee in the background of one of these staff, they just keep hiring you as long as you're not a wacko that stares into the camera or talks to the talent or anything.
Right.
So I worked on Vegas a lot.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. I would say probably the most of any of the other shows I worked on. I worked on pretty much every show between 2006 and 2008.
Did you ever keep any souvenirs from the set?
Did I? I don't think I did. That's very frowned upon. And I was.
I know.
Unfortunately, I was an extremely disciplined, professional rule follower. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you're super method background actor.
Super method, yes.
So you're like, you know, I wouldn't steal from this casino.
You joke, but I worked on Boston Legal for one day, and I was replacing a woman who was, like I said, the established receptionist, but I guess I looked like her, and she was sick, so they had me replace her, and everybody kept coming up to me going, where's Cadence? You're not Cadence. And I was like, oh, she's sick. And you go, hi, I'm Phil. I'm a paralegal. And yeah. They literally thought they really were lawyers. They really thought they were really going to work.
Oh, my.
It was pretty intense.
That's sad.
Well, you know, everybody's got bills to pay.
Yeah, but, you know,
it was like, interesting. It was an interesting character study and, you know, bless him.
Oh, boy. maybe it's good I didn't move out to Los Angeles. Tuesday, what'd you do?
Okay, I was having a hard time on Tuesday. I wanted to watch America's Next Top Model from the opening of the TV Guide, but it premieres next week. So I was bummed about that because I have seen, Ken, every episode of America's Next Top Model that has ever aired.
I'm going to confess something to you. So have I.
Oh, look at you. You haven't seen The Wire, but you've seen all the top models.
I love the world of fashion models.
Yeah, yeah.
I was a huge House of Style fan.
Okay.
Just like actually, this won't translate to the listener, but like this is literally just in my office. It's
oh my gosh.
Yeah, yeah, it's Shalom Harlow on Elle magazine.
Wow.
From like 1996.
That's my era. The late 90s, early 2000s. I have a ton of YM magazines and People's and stuff. They're my favorite thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was a big Sassy reader.
Okay, yeah, I have a couple of those.
So, and I worked at our UPN affiliate at the time of the second season of Next Top Model. So we did all the auditions there.
Wow.
And we also did Survivor auditions for the second season. So like Elizabeth Hasselbeck came in. Uh-huh. We had an obstacle course set up in the parking. Ridiculous.
Oh
ridiculous.
My gosh. That is so funny.
But I remember when I lived in England, whatever Next Top Model was, it was called Model Behavior. Mm-hmm. So that was the British version before they did it here. And I watched it every week. And I remember one of the girls who was in like the top three lived in the same part of London I lived in. I used to see her at the supermarket all the time buying the generic stuff.
Uh-huh.
And it made me really sad.
Hey, I buy the generic. It's the same shit.
Yeah, I know. I've come around. I'm an adult now.
Yeah, yeah.
But like I'm 21, you know, I'm like, oh, right. That's sad. That's a shame.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm glad
so,
she was saving her money. Smart, yeah, smart moves.
She's doing well now. I have no idea if that's true. But yeah, I watched all those as well. So I'm right there with you on that.
I was bummed because I would totally have watched that. But instead, I chose to watch Punk'd, as we talked about earlier. Now, you say oof. I loved Punk'd when I was younger. I don't know if it holds up, which is why I chose it. Because I was like, I'd like to rewatch this and see if it's still good. Because there are some iconic moments from Punk'd.
I find Ashton
opinion,
Kutcher
insufferable.
Yeah.
I used to be in love with him, but now I reject it completely.
I see a Von Dutch hat and I just want to start throwing fists. I think probably just because of that show.
Yeah.
I don't know how more people didn't get punched.
Well, there were some that's why this show worked. I mean, the first episode with Justin Timberlake is such good television.
So it was always celebrities.
Yes.
Okay. Well,
and they deserve to get picked on. Yeah.
They worked for bloopers and practical jokes. It worked for Punk.
Yes. No, but the first episode, they tell Justin Timberlake that they're repossessing all his stuff. And he literally breaks down and puts his head down. And he's like, why is this happening? Like, it's so pure. So I had to watch it. It's been a long time. I wanted to check it out. So I'm watching that. And then I put on Pulp Fiction, which is on one of the Cinemaxes. And the reason I wanted to watch this is because I have not watched Pulp Fiction in a very long time, and I would like to rewatch it. It's been too long.
I saw it once, really hated it.
Yeah.
I don't like Tarantino.
See, I'm the opposite.
Yeah,
I can't.
Can't stand him. I used to call him the Puff Daddy of movies, in that he just sampled from better movies.
Uh-huh.
So I'm like, he has good taste.
Yeah. I hear that, but the way he pulls it all together and makes it his own vision.
Sure, sure.
I'm a Quentin Tarantino apologist. Okay, I love his. I see every movie. I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood twice in theaters.
So here's the thing. I did like that.
Yeah.
I had some problems with it, but I liked it because I saw it at the New Bev.
Yeah.
And so it was more like an immersive ride. It was like a pop-up experience. Yep. Like, I don't think I would have liked it as much.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I probably would like it better a second time because I knew the ending and I'm not just sitting there waiting for the bad thing to happen because I know that it never does.
Yeah. Yep.
Because that, I was just like, like the whole time.
So my Tuesday night programming is not for you.
No, this is this is an opposite. Andy Ken night.
Okay, well, so what are you watching then?
So this is a tough one. So I never saw Eight Simple Rules. This is after
John Ritter.
John Ritter has died, and they've replaced him with David Spade and James Garner.
Okay.
Because when you think, who do we replace John Ritter with? It's got to be two people.
Yes.
Well, clearly it's David Spade and James Garner. Tracy Morgan, speaking of Tracy Morgan, had his own sitcom at this time, which I also never saw.
Yeah.
But I'm kind of intrigued with now because he's such a crazy person.
Yeah.
I cannot imagine him being contained in a sitcom.
Did you watch 30 Rock?
I never saw 30 Rock.
Yeah, I never watched it either, but he was on that.
But the Terminator's on, and I will always watch the original
I don't think I've watched it.
The first one? Have you seen any of them?
I don't think so.
Oh, the first one's great. And it's so very LA, too. It's super 80s LA.
Okay, like I need to watch it.
Yeah. The first Terminator is fantastic. I love that. Whoopi Goldberg's sitcom Whoopi is on, and Rue McClanahan is in this episode. I think it's one of the last things she ever did. There's According to Jim... But Lorraine Newman and Dan Aykroyd are in this episode.
So you love a sitcom.
I do love a sitcom. Yeah. See, that one, so According to Jim, was created by Lorraine's sister, Tracy Newman. And they founded the Groundlings together. So I'm kind of intrigued that she brought in her sister and Dan Aykroyd into this episode. Like, I'm curious just to see what that's about.
Yeah, I bet it's fun.
But yeah, probably Terminator all night.
Yeah, fair.
Yeah, because The Real World is on... which is after 10, so it's not really in the purview. But by this time, I had totally checked out of The Real World because this is when it's just all about fighting and fucking. It's like everyone screw each other and then punch each other and no one's interesting and they're super generic people.
I feel like I had fallen off by now as well, but I might have maybe seen around this time, but intermittently. I did a lot of it.
I'm reading the synopsis for this one. This is The Return to San Diego. This is crazy. The quintessential reality series kicks off its 14th season with the roommates settling into their waterfront digs in San Diego. And while each new edition of the series garners attention, this one made headlines before a single episode aired. During a filming in September, a female cast member, Robin, 22, was involved in a bar fight with a male Marine. And in November, a woman alleged she was raped by a cast member's acquaintance in the house's bathroom, a room without cameras. It remains to be seen if MTV deems these events too real for The Real World. I'm curious now how they handled those on the actual show.
I don't remember seeing any of that or hearing about any of that.
I'm genuinely intrigued how they handle those two things in the series now. I've rewatched the first three or four seasons of The Real World. I still love them. I love The Real World Reunion. I was like, the one from last year for the first season, I was like, this is the greatest ever.
Aren't they still married, the doctor and the...
Oh, yeah. Judd and Pam.
That's so cute.
Yeah, they're the best. They're just good, genuinely good people.
Yes. Yeah. It was before they only put train wrecks in a house.
Yeah, like they were putting like interesting people together who wouldn't mix together normally.
Right.
And they're like, what? Instead of just like, who's really hot and fucking
and stupid.
Crazy?
Yeah.
Perfect. Which is really a pretty good summation of.
Well, there's
culture.
A lot of shows now that's literally what they are.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like the Hot People Island is just like everyone that is, they're insanely hot. Like they're just so good looking that it's almost painful to look at them, but they're all idiots.
Oh, of course. Because we're like.
Nobody gets both. Let's be honest.
No, they've never had to do anything.
Right, exactly. They didn't have to develop a brain.
Right.
They
exactly.
look perfect. Why would you have to? I wouldn't.
Everyone does everything for them. They even mama bird their food.
Yes.
So where are we? Wednesday night?
Wednesday night. Okay, this is a Fox night for me.
Okay.
I'm doing 70 shows, Simple Life in the OC, and solid programming that I'm a big fan of all of those. Bring it on.
I will say, I really enjoyed That 70s Show.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot watch it now because like half the cast are rapists.
Same, yeah. It's sad.
It's super gross and creepy, but what a well-written show.
Yes.
Really funny sitcom.
Great timing, great script, great costumes.
Do you remember That 80s Show?
I never watched it. It didn't last very long, right?
No, half a season. I was very disappointed by it. But again, show I always liked. Mm-hmm. There's a show called Ed on, which I remember being kind of like a little phenomenon and people really liked it. Michael Ian Black was in it.
Mm-hmm.
It was like kind of a quiet show. It sort of reminded me of Northern Exposure. I'd like to rewatch it because
I would like to watch it. I love Michael Ian Black.
Yeah. And it was a pretty good show as far as I remember, but that was on as well. I never saw The Surreal Life. I mean, not The Surreal Life.
The Simple Life.
That's Paris Hilton and
Nicole
Richie.
It's so good. Is it really pure. Well, it was. I don't know. I'd have to revisit it, which is why I'd like to watch it. It was so, so entertaining at the time.
So it was just like, we're rich and we can't do anything. So this episode is the ladies get jobs at a gas station food mart and bait shop and soon reel in two boys as customers who they'll accompany to a club. In doing so, they stay out beyond their curfew.
So the show premise was these two rich Los Angeles socialites, heiresses, if you will. They put them in the middle of Podunk USA.
Okay.
And they say, okay, this is how the other side lives. It was a wife swap sort of concept.
Fish out of water.
Yes, a life swap. Not a wife swap, a life swap. And obviously now we've seen the Paris documentary, we know her past, but this was right when she was coming into this brand of, I act like an idiot, even though we all know she's really actually very smart, and this was a very strategic move and things. But her and Nicole Richie are hilarious. Like, they truly have amazing comedic, and they don't have a script. This is out of their mouths. Just
they have an outline.
They have an outline. But I'm telling you, it was great. It was really entertaining, and they're fun, and they're really fun to look at, let's be honest. They're both hot, and they wear hot outfits, and they're funny, and it was pure joy. It was a pure joy show.
This is also when you could get mainstream famous by having a leaked sex tape.
Yes.
Which,
have you seen the Paris Hilton documentary?
No, I haven't seen it.
Oh, you got to watch it.
Is it good?
Oh, yeah. It's once again, she was one of these women of this time period that was really treated unfairly in many ways.
She seemed in on some of it.
Well, you got to watch the documentary.
Okay, I will watch.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
I will mention before we get to the OC, because I know that you love it and was one of the main reasons here. Sid and Nancy's on, which I would also always watch. I love that movie. They're also showing it Letterbox, which sounds silly now as being a big deal. But seeing a movie in 2004, Letterbox, especially a movie I loved on TV, was like appointment television.
Yes. I hear that. I've never seen it.
It's not my favorite Alex Cox movie. That would be Repo Man. But it's very interesting. It's a weird movie. And I'm also like, I'll watch anything that's about like punk rock in the 70s and 80s. So Gary Oldman's always interesting to watch, even when he's not great. Courtney Love has a small part in it, which is very weird. It's a very strange movie. I've actually talked to Alex Cox about doing this show.
Wow.
And he was very nice, but he's just like, I don't like TV, I only like films. And he wrote a book about the show The Prisoner. And I'm like, didn't you just write a book about the show The Prisoner? He's like, that's the only show I like. It's like, perfect. So The OC, I would get confused with, there was a reality show as well.
Yes. Laguna Beach.
That was
Beach.
The Hills? Oh, Laguna Beach. Okay.
Yeah.
What was The Hills?
The Hills was the offshoot of Laguna Beach.
So also a reality show.
Yes, but that was the whole thing. The OC was so big that MTV said, we're going to make a reality show based on the same place in time.
It was
called Laguna Beach, the real Orange County.
I see. Okay. So
they
OC...
were profiting off of the OC's success.
So this was on Fox. This was sort of the heir to 90210.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
Mm-hmm.
This was 90210, I think, ended in like 99. So this started in like 2002 or 3.
Mm-hmm.
And this is sort of the new California rich kids show.
Dramedy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the main girl in it, whose name I can't remember.
Misha Barton. Mm-hmm.
She was massive.
Yes. Like overnight.
But I haven't seen her in years.
Yeah, her career you know, once again, she had a rough time. And the tabloids and the paparazzi, and I really think, and I think there was some mental health, some drug problem. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there's some things hit her hard. And, yeah, and honestly, as far as I can tell, the cast isn't friendly with her. There's a podcast, which I do hate when celebrities do podcasts, but Rachel Bilson has a OC recap podcast. Okay. And because I love the OC and the pilot so much, I listened to the first episode where they went through the pilot with Josh Schwartz, the creator of the show, and it's really interesting. They just kind of pretend she doesn't exist. Like, they That's really weird. They just go, oh, and they move on to the next. I think there was some creative differences, to say the least, but it's rough out there for a young woman and having the spotlight on you very quickly. And I honestly don't know enough about it to comment, but respect to Misha Barton and everybody involved, and I hope she's doing okay now.
Because I remember she had, like, dual citizenship with the UK, so when I lived in the UK, she was there a lot.
Oh, yeah, I think her parents
Yeah,
or she was born there.
Maybe she just moved. But is that a show that I should bother watching?
I think, honestly, this is going to sound intense. The pilot of the OC is one of the best pilots that I have ever personally seen.
What makes it so great?
Every sentence, every line of dialogue, every shot informs the story forward. It is truly, in terms of screenwriting, incredible at showing you this world and delivering information in a very precise, effective way. Every shot, every glance, it's so well done. And listening to that podcast with Josh Schwartz, I was like at the edge of my chair. I was just like, this is so good. Like, now, most shows, there are little weird parts and seasons that aren't the best, and people have to be killed off in order to move on and things like that. But the pilot is incredible. I stand
by that.
I'll
watch the pilot. I'll watch the pilot. I will
do
that.
It's really, really good.
Before we move on to Thursday, there's something really annoying me here. There's a TV Guide choice of something to watch, and it's Blondie performs in New York City. The New Wave icons cover some of their biggest hits, including One Way or Another, Rapture, and Heart of Glass. But the the headline says, "We got the beat."
Oh, no.
Which
That's
is
not
a GoGos song. And it really, it's like, I'm like getting red with anger.
You hate the guy who writes the headlines
for
this.
Come on, man. Like, I know you can't Google stuff in 2004. You might have to ask Jeeves. But, like, someone in the office would be like, oh, dude, I think that's actually not, I think that's the Go-Go's.
Yeah.
And he went out. Who cares? No one knows.
That's what it was. I think they had somebody write a bunch of lazy headlines for this whole article.
Yeah.
And, you know,
they're like, who's
do a punch
care?
Up. Do a punch up next time.
Go. And in 17 years, what's some dude in Boston going to be doing a podcast about it?
Like, then they say, what's a podcast? A
yeah. He goes, it's a Go-Go song. Thursday, what'd you do?
Okay. So, first of all, I need to say, you just said you love being nosy and going through people's stuff. Before primetime starts, Room Raiders is on MTV, and you need to watch it if you have not seen it.
So
have you seen Room Raiders?
It was like, I'm going to date this person, but go through their bedroom first?
Yeah. So they would, this is the idea. There's a guy sitting in his room, and all of a sudden they run in and they grab him and they throw him in a van, which doesn't hold up, but you know. Mm-hmm. They get in the van, it's three guys and a TV, and they're like, okay, we now have a hot girl who's going to go through each of your rooms, and based on their room, she's going to pick one of you to date. And you watch this girl go through, and she puts gloves on. They get that black light on your bed to see your dirty jizz.
No.
They go through your garbage. It is so, and obviously we know it's all staged and fake, you know, but before we knew that, it's really pure entertainment. It's just one of those shows you can turn off your brain and judge and sit back, and it's great. I miss it, to be honest.
It's kind of amazing that MTV had a show that was essentially teenage jizz light.
Yes. No, and they showed it.
Of course. Of course.
They showed it.
Man, because I think around this time, Pimp My Ride was also big.
Yep, yep.
There's a guy on YouTube, and I watched this a couple weeks ago. He bought one of the Pimp My Ride cars for $400. This is like,
oh my god,
recently. Like, it was a 2004. It was a van they did, and it was just derelict. And it was in.
Will you send me the link? I need to see that.
It's really funny. So he goes through this thing, and he's like, "This thing smells really bad."
Oh,
and like,
my
but
god!
But I'll send you the link. It's really, really entertaining to see what happened to those cars.
Well, yeah, because the whole idea was these kids had shitty cars. Clearly, they don't take care of anything, and then they gave them these expensive custom vehicles. I'm like, they're gonna crash it. They're gonna sell it. It's gonna get stolen. Like, that was very silly.
And apparently 99% of the time, the car that they gave them is not their same car.
Oh, that makes sense.
They'd buy like a better version.
Yeah.
Or like one that's not as beat up. And that's the case with this van. It's like a van, and they buy like a van that's kind of like it, mm-hmm. and then do it up. But it's, I will send that to you, and then I'm dying to hear what
you think. Oh, I cannot wait to see that. Where are we? Thursday,
yes.
Okay. Wait, are we on Thursday? Okay.
Yes, Room Raiders was on before 8 o'clock. Yep.
So I originally was going to watch The Apprentice, and only because I was going to bring up that I actually used to watch that and enjoy it, but then I realized I can't watch that.
No.
I can't give that a rating. I can't even go there. Because
part of me
at first was like, well, what if we all watch it and then the future never happens because this show gets so many people to watch and it sets the path? And I'm like, no. Just don't watch it. Give it no mind. So I erased it from my lineup. No, we are not watching The Apprentice. So instead, I'm watching, obviously, Friends.
This is the final season of Friends?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm a big Friends head.
Okay.
Have you seen Friends?
I have seen Friends. I'm not a fan.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Actually, she passed away, but I had Allie Willis on, who wrote the theme song.
Wow.
She also wrote September by Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Oh, wow. I hope she got a good payday for that, because that song's used in so many commercials.
Oh, yes. She was on welfare living in Detroit and wrote that song. And she also best friends with Pee Wee Herman.
Wow. What a life.
Mm-hmm.
We celebrate you. We celebrate you today.
Yes. But that's
I love Friends, and I had to watch it, obviously. And so after Friends ends, I decided to go watch Guts. It's on channel NGAS, which I don't know what that means. Yep. I thought it would be Noggin.
Nickelodeon Games and Sports.
Okay. So I loved this show growing up. I wanted to be on Guts. I wanted to be the warrior supreme and
do you have it?
Do you have it? So I was like, well, if Guts is on, I'd rather watch that and see what's going on there. So I watched Guts.
I had the biggest crush on Mo.
Oh, yes. She's amazing. She, I feel like, I had a friend who did a live comedy show in L.A., and she was the guest.
Oh,
she gave my friend a piece of the crag.
You can't just give. You have to earn that.
No, not if you're Mo.
Wow.
I know.
Yeah, I guess. I just imagine her always wearing that referee outfit.
Yeah, of course you do. Of course you do.
Oh,
I see you. Yeah.
I'd read that room.
Exactly. I get that black light out.
Someone's on Room Raiders and they're like, the aggro crag.
Oh man, if I was room raiding a guy and he had an aggro crag, I would not be it. I'd say, end the show. I'm dating him.
We get married right
He's
now?
He's a warrior. I had to check that out. And then what did I do? Okay, I was gonna watch the most problematic show probably ever, Extreme Makeover. Mm-hmm. I feel if aliens came to Earth and they opened up a time capsule that encapsulated our current world, that would be the show that would really represent us as a society in the worst way, but the most accurate way. So I think it's an interesting piece. I think it's an interesting piece commentating on where we're at in society. So I would check that out. And I do love, unfortunately, a good plastic surgery show.
Well, see, I'm super squeamish, so I get grossed out. But
yeah,
one of the things that people forget is because Extreme Makeover Home Edition went on for like 10 years.
And it was a spin-off of
that. It might still be on. Which people totally forget about the original Extreme Makeover, which was let's get some ugly people and make, and then they did like a dating thing with them as well.
Oh, right.
Because all I remember is when I first moved back to Boston, was doing stand up here, there were like 8 hacky comics who had like these 2 ugly people and they're gonna have a kid who's gonna look like their original faces.
Yeah. Yeah,
kind of stuff.
Yeah,
just on and on. I was like, man, that's rough. I think I'd watch the show True Calling.
Okay,
which was Eliza Dushku,
mm-hmm.
and she basically played a woman who could like speak with the dead.
Okay, mm-hmm.
And
I remember that show.
Yeah. It was kind of a cool show.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty under the radar. I think it was like two seasons, but it was, you know, not offensive. It was like decently done.
Who was the creator? Wasn't it somebody pretty good?
I think it's something else.
I feel like it's not J.J. Abrams, but a similar-ish person, or I'm losing my mind, which is also very possible.
It could be. Let me see. No, I have like a weird no looking things up rule, but I'm totally looking this up.
Oh.
Let's see. True Calling was created by.
I always make people break the rules.
John Harmon Feldman?
Nope. Don't know.
Nope. Let's see what else he did. You know, John Harmon Feldman.
Yeah, you know.
He worked on the Wonder Years, Dawson's Creek, Dirty Sexy Money, Big Shots, Roswell.
Decent resume.
Yeah.
Have you seen Dawson's Creek?
Yeah, I hated it so
much. Oh, wow. You and I. We do not have similar.
We wouldn't be friends.
I mean, we're friends, but we're gonna go out. We're not gonna stay at home because I feel like TV we will not agree on.
There'd be some arguments. I remember there was a friend of my sister's who was this girl that my father found really annoying. She did like a. There was like an MTV show where you could like write in and ask them to like. I forget what it was called now, but it was like Make It Happen or whatever. And she wanted.
Is it MTV Made?
No, it wasn't Made. Although I do know a guy who was on Made. He was like a punk rock kid, they taught him how to conduct a symphony.
I want to go on MTV Made right now.
My friend used to cast that show. I forget what this was called, but she wrote in and she got to go to the set of Dawson's Creek and like meet the cast and everything.
Was it MTV Fanatic?
Maybe that might have been
that show was awesome.
That might have been it because I remember my dad was flipping through the channels and he saw her on TV and he was like. So angry.
Yeah. Hey, the squeaky wheel gets the grease, you know?
I do love Joshua Jackson.
Yeah, me too.
He's amazing on Fringe. Incredible actor. One of my favorite shows of all time. By all accounts, solid, good dude.
Mm-hmm. Have you seen his wife?
No.
Oh, my God. You have to look it up. Stunning and hilarious. And I'm telling you, he really gets the good women.
He should.
Yeah, he should. I agree. But
good for him.
I want to say she's British and she's just like checks every box of like hot, funny, smart woman. Good for him.
Good job.
I think they met doing
Jackson.
A Broadway show. Yeah.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Good for him. I'm gonna high
good
five.
For him. We stand.
So yeah, I'm watching True Calling, which was just like okay as far as I remember. We're not watching the A Word show with the Grimace.
Nope.
God, I'd love to punch him in the fucking face. And Extreme Makeover. A 49-year-old mother of three and a barely can't see the words, 20-something. Clerk get the royal treatment.
Oh.
Sissy Biggers hosts? I don't even know who that is.
Me neither.
All right. And then The Simple Life is on again.
I saw, yeah. I might have checked that out.
That was super popular. Remember how popular The Osbournes was as well?
It was so good.
Man.
It was so good.
Also, The Chris Isaac Show is on at 10 o'clock. Love Chris Isaac.
Mm-hmm.
Huge fan. Speaking of super talented good dudes, former Golden Gloves boxer. Wow. Never had a drink or drug in his life.
Wow.
Funny, amazing musician. Had his own sitcom on Showtime. Very dated.
Yeah.
Always had nudity in it that seemed shoved into the show because this is back when cable was like, we can do it.
Let's get some bush and tits out.
Yeah. And you're like, this doesn't seem like it naturally fits in this show. But in this particular episode... Poisons Bret Michaels plays himself.
Okay, well, I would be interested in that.
So I'm curious to see how the two of them interact.
Yeah.
Final night of the week, Friday night, what'd you do?
Okay. Friday. I'm watching Queer Eye for the Straight Guy on Bravo 8 to 9. Mm-hmm. This show, loved it, watched every episode. My cousin was actually made over on Queer Eye for the Straight Guy.
Oh, nice.
Yep.
Did it stick?
It did stick. And he has a gorgeous wife with a great job. I swear they turned his life around.
Nice.
Truly. And they had his whole place made over, and it was really fun. I flew into New York to be at the, like, reveal party.
Oh, wow.
It was so fun. It was actually right around this time. It was 2004 or 5. So, yeah.
Wow. You have a much more exciting life than I do.
Well, back in the early 2000s, oh, man, I was living my life.
But that show, again, I think people know about it now because there's been that reboot on Netflix, yes, which is very good, but a totally different show.
Yes, completely different show.
Totally different.
Yes.
The new one is much more like, let's fix what's wrong with
more
the,
progressive.
Your life.
Yeah.
And this
was
literally
more surface.
You dress like a slob and
they made fun of you. And yeah, they really hurt my cousin's feelings.
Was there something specific that he still hangs on to this day?
They told him his feet stunk. And I'll just reveal the secrets. Everybody by now knows reality TV show is very fake.
Yes.
His hair, they made him basically, his hair looked way worse than it actually did. They said, you're not allowed to get your hair cut. So, like, months in pre-production, they were like, no more cutting your hair. And I think they made him go get his hair, like, bleached so it looked worse. So
looked like he was in
Everclear.
He
was like, I have to walk around looking like an asshole for 3 months before they shoot this show. Like,
they're like, we'll buy you new furniture.
Yeah, I would do it. I'd look like shit for 3 months for new furniture.
I'd do that for free.
Yeah, same.
Like those shows where, those reality shows where they're like, you're going to buy a house. Is it this one or this one?
Right.
They've
so
always
fake.
Already bought one
yes.
of the houses.
Yes.
It's like, yeah. But
they
show
actually
was,
do a, they do a pretty good job on those shows of acting, non-actors.
Pretending like, I've never seen this house, even though they've been living in it for 3 weeks.
A year.
But Queer for the Straight Guy was kind of groundbreaking in that, you know, much like the way, like, I'm always surprised by who watches Drag Race now.
Uh-huh.
It's like,
yes.
Your uncle.
Yes, like people, it's very popular.
Like, really? Yeah. But this was kind of like that, in that this was like the first gay people a lot of people watched in a show, and it wasn't an episode where like they got AIDS and died, which was like every gay show before that. And they were like, no, they're fun guys.
It probably opened a lot of people's eyes up, for sure.
Yeah. Oh, totally. And I think 2004 was when gay marriage passed in Massachusetts, if I'm remembering. So it was like this kind of a
revolution
big year. Yeah,
yeah.
Which I think we take for granted now, how weird it was. And how weird it was to see a show with five guys, five gay guys who we were like, they're all experts and really good at something.
You know,
it wasn't just like the bitchy best friend or like, you know, like a tragedy.
It
you
definitely
know?
Opened up doors and opened people's eyes and was a big step in representation, as well as a really fun, well done show.
Yeah, everyone loves a makeover show.
Yeah, of course. I really liked that show. So I watched that, and then 9 to 10. You know, Ken, I just have to know VH1's Hottest Hotties Countdown. I needed to check it out, and I wanted to just say that I really did watch this. I remember watching this, so that's why I picked this, because I was like, you know what? I need to see who the Hottest Hotties are. And this goes on for hours and hours.
Do you remember who they were?
I don't, but damn it, I wish I did. Because this is information that I could use in my life. This is information
who's the
100... top hottie? Who could it be?
And it was male and female.
Yes.
Okay, so they alternated. 100 Hottest Hotties.
Yes, 100 Hottest Hotties Countdown.
Listeners, if you know or could tell us who the
because we're not allowed to look it up, right?
We can't look it up.
Okay.
You want to look it up now?
I'll follow the rules.
I'm curious.
Okay,
I'd be curious if anyone actually has this online.
Oh, of course they do. Hottest Hotties.
Let's see. All right. No, what is this? That's the Village Voice. VH1's top 40 videos of the year. Yeah, no.
No
one's listed the Hottest Hotties.
What? Oh, no. I'm offended.
Oh, wait. No, I got it.
Okay.
All right. Do you want me to go from 100 and go down?
No. Give us top 10. Top 10.
All right.
Hottest Hotties of 2004.
First of all, Misha Barton is number 14.
Okay.
15.
Yeah.
Number 10. Oh, God. No, number 11.
Uh-huh.
J-Lo's ass.
Okay, no. Come on.
Number 10.
Not objectify women.
Number
10. 2004, the peak time period for that.
Viggo Mortensen.
Okay.
Number 9, Pam Anderson.
Okay.
Number 8, 50 Cent.
Okay.
Number 7, Halle Berry.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Number 6, Brad Pitt.
Okay.
Number 5, Johnny Depp.
Okay.
4 is Britney Spears.
Okay.
3 is our good friend Ashton Kutcher.
Your buddy.
2 is Angelina Jolie.
Okay.
And Who's your guess for number one?
Oh, God. 2004. Oh, this is my time. I should know.
You're gonna feel bad that you don't know it.
Oh, yeah, of course. Okay, 2004. Oh, yeah. It's not the Friends. They've already probably are a little older.
Past their prime.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you want a hint?
Yes.
It's a musical artist.
Okay. 2004. Okay. Justin Timberlake?
No, he was in the top 20. It's a female.
Oh. 2004. It's not Britney. Fuck.
Nope.
Okay. I'm going
it's
back.
Not Christina.
This is my time. This is my time. Yeah. It's not Christina. Female, 2004. Ashanti?
Beyonce.
Oh, yeah!
Yeah. Right? You're like, oh, obviously.
Dangerously in Love was like my favorite CD in 2004.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Man.
I mean, it's going to be Beyonce in 2004.
Yeah, of course. It still is. It's Beyonce would still be the hottest hottie.
Yeah, she looks pretty much exactly
incredible.
The same.
Yeah. Money's the best lotion.
Yeah. So I will mention I would watch Life with Bonnie that night, which is Bonnie Hunt's third and final sitcom, which was really great.
Mm-hmm,
this
I'm
is
sure.
the first season. Mm-hmm. Very funny. And there was one other thing that I was going to watch. Where was it? I saw it and it looked weird. It was a movie? What was I watching? Oh, Police Story Part 2, which is a Jackie Chan movie that they gave 3 stars to. And I'm actually really shocked that it was playing on TV in 2004. So as you know, Jackie, the TV Guide, it is not just informative. It has opinions and it cheers and it jeers.
Yes, yes.
And I would like to read you the cheers and jeers of this week in 2004 and see if we agree or disagree as our way outside of this here. So this is a split week. But we're on the cheers side. We have 4 cheers, 3 jeers.
Okay.
We start with a cheers. To 24 for flipping the script. When we thought CTU employee Gail, played by Jesse Barajai, was a mole, we left it as if we were watching a rerun of season 1 with in-house saboteur Nina, played by Sarah Clark. But when it turned out Gail was just posing as a spy to help super agent Jack Bauer, Kiefer Sutherland, go back undercover with the bad guys, we remembered why we watched Fox's brilliantly twisty real-time thriller.
I've never watched 24. I know people loved it. you know, good for them. I don't know what the hell they're talking about.
Me either.
Yeah.
That's pretty in the weeds. Cheers to Jack Osbourne for gamely filling in for his mum, Sharon, as the host of her self-titled syndicated talk show. When Sharon flew off to England to be with her seriously injured husband, Ozzy, after his all-terrain vehicle incident, Jack subbed like a good son. Now if he would just cut that hair.
Huh. I love the Osbourne family. They've always been really fun and on television. But, Jack, you're allowed to have long hair if you want, man.
Yeah, and also, what was he, 17? And he's filling in for his mom
I think
on a talk
we're the
show?
Same age. I think I'm the same age as Jack Osbourne. I might be the same age as Kelly Osbourne, but we're very similarly aged. We're in the same kind of time period, so I always support them.
Okay, fair enough. Jeers to E! For stretching the title of its true Hollywood story by doing an episode about Bill Clinton. If they called it a true DC story, maybe we'd buy it. But treating Clinton's scandals as Tinseltown takes a reach. Unless you're talking about Brother Roger's role as Mayor Bubba in the 1994 movie Pumpkinhead 2, Blood Wings.
Ooh, I don't get that reference. What are they saying?
They did an E! True Hollywood story about Bill Clinton and the Monica Lewinsky thing. And so TV Guide is mad that they did a true Hollywood story about a president.
Got it. So it should be true DC story. Got it.
But shut up, E.
Yeah.
Shut up, TV Guide.
Yeah. I see their point. I see their point, but who cares?
Yeah, it's a salacious show.
Yeah, yeah.
jeers to the coverage of Trista and Ryan's wedding for crossing the line between hype and hyperbole. It all began with the most beautiful wedding proposal anyone has ever seen, host Chris Harrison intoned, adding the whole world watched. True, ABC's reality show drew big ratings, but the whole world, that's the worst exaggeration anyone has ever heard. I don't even know what show this was.
So, Trista and Ryan, I think they're still married.
Was the show called Trista and Ryan?
No, it was The Bachelorette.
Oh.
It was the first ever Bachelorette.
Okay.
And their wedding was this huge deal. I remember there were helicopters. You could barely even hear their vows because there were so many helicopters trying to get footage, and it was a whole thing. So
wow.
I say it was a big deal. I agree the whole world wasn't watching, but it was a big deal.
Okay, so it's like a half agree with them.
Yeah.
Cheers to Barry Bostwick for his guest starring turn as a prostate cancer patient on NBC's Scrubs. A real-life survivor of the disease, the former Spin City mayor indelibly embodied a repressed man struggling to deal with a terrifying diagnosis. More than just funny, Bostwick's performance was fearless.
The person who wrote this loves a thesaurus.
Oh, yeah.
That was a lot of words.
And Barry Bostwick.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, I like Barry Bostwick, too, and, you know, cool, he was on Scrubs. But this is very, very, they're very happy about that.
Yeah, they're really into it.
Jeers to Snoop speak run amok. At first, it was cute, with the line popularized by rapper Snoop Doggy Dogg on MTV's Doggy Fizzle Televizzle started popping up in commercials and sitcom punchlines. But when Fran Drescher declares at one of those annoying Old Navy ads that, quote, my shizzle's gone fizzle, it's official. This trend has fizzled.
Who wrote this? Dr. Seuss?
I think so. Some old man who loves rhyme. I will say, it is annoying.
I think, don't yuck somebody's yum. You know, yeah, who cares? I will say, those Old Navy commercials, I was younger, but I found them amusing at the time.
Yeah, I enjoyed how, like, just weird they were.
They were weird, and yeah. I appreciate that. I appreciate the weird pacing, the absurdity.
The odd line readings, the non-actors. Yeah,
yes.
I'm going to disagree with them. And finally, cheers to Jimmy Kimmel and Ellen DeGeneres for earning well-deserved season renewals. Neither ABC's Jimmy Kimmel Live nor syndication's The Ellen DeGeneres Show has set the Nielsens ablaze, and yet both hosts have shown the potential to take the chat genre in new and very different directions.
Wow. Well, you know, these shows are still on.
That's true.
So
one of those people's a monster.
Yeah. We'll let y'all decide who we're talking about.
Google it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's pretty prescient because there were so many talk shows and they all fizzled out, and to pick those two out as ones that would be going on for a while, they kind of nailed it.
They were right. Yeah, they were right.
Fair enough. Is there anything you've been watching in lockdown or like a comfort show you've been gone back to in the last year?
You're going to hate this, but Friends. I've been watching Friends. It's been really fun. I'm in season four. I've never watched it all in order before, and I've been watching like three a night, and it's really fun. I've been having a really good time with it.
Sitcoms are a good way to unwind before bed.
Yep.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I'm glad we finally got to do it.
Oh, same. I remember when I met you at Alison Rosen's house, which, remember, that was like right before lockdown.
We were the last people to do it in person.
Y'all were the last. You were in the room with me, the last people in a room that I was in for like a year.
Yeah.
And I think I even like DM'd you and was like, hey, you don't have COVID, right? Like, I'm scared. And you're like, no, I don't have COVID. Like, it was crazy.
It was freaky.
But I remember when she told me about your show, I was like, oh, I have to come on. Because I'm a latchkey kid, you know, broken home. All I did was watch TV. And
it's made us who we are today.
It certainly has. And I knew, because you and I have such a different opinion on shows, that it would be a very interesting episode. I learned a lot from you. You learned a lot from me.
Yep. We're both better people for it.
We both are.
Thank you. Now I'll have to come on and talk about beauty tips.
Yeah, that, you know, no offense, but you're not really my target demo.
But I haven't cut my hair in 3 weeks.
Wow. Okay. I bleached it
so you could do a makeover.
Oh, perfect.
Can't wait. Fair enough.
Do your feet smell because I'll make fun of you. I'm sure.
I don't know. I can work on it.
Yeah. Perfect.
Okay. There you go. That's Jackie. Also, I forgot the name of the show we were talking about, that like horrific prank show, and it's Scare Tactics. And as you can imagine, Fear Factor and Scare Tactics, pretty similar names. So I had a brain block there, but it is Scare Tactics. So there you go. Things that aren't scary, Natch Beaut, you should go to her website. I'll put links up on tvguidancecounselor.com and all the social media. If you want to email me, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. or CanadaICanRead.com. That is my stand-up comedy page. I still don't know if I'll be out doing live shows again or conventions. Things were looking promising, but then Delta, so everything's kind of been canceled. I had some trips planned, which I have since canceled, but I will keep you updated. So if you don't follow me on social media, please do so at Kenneth W. Reed, and that's where I will alert everyone if I am leaving my house. Literally, if I'm leaving my house, I will let you guys know. Not so you can come rob me, but more just, you know, feel like you want to know. But if you want to email me, ask any guests that you may want to have on the show. I always try to get them. Let me know how you guys are doing. Let me know what you're watching. And we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
My dad is an identical twin. He doesn't have amazing tits, and I think he would be okay with me saying that.
It's the opposite.
Wait, what do you mean?